Hey, brothers and sisters, this is your most favorite brother from another mother. Hallelujah. Praise the living God. Hallelujah. I came on here, brothers and sisters, just to praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And worship Him with you. You know, the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord inhabits the praises of His people. So let's worship Him right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I came to worship You. I came to love You, Lord, Your holy name to praise. Hallelujah. Oh, how I worship You. Hallelujah. Father, we come before You. We bow before You in the name of Jesus Christ. All blessing and honor and glory and praise be unto You, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Unto You who sits at the right hand of God. Hallelujah. Give Him blessing and honor, glory and power, riches and wisdom and strength. Yes, Lord, You are worthy of all blessing and honor, glory and power, riches and wisdom and strength be unto You who sits at the right hand of God, be unto You, yes, Lord, who sits at the right hand of God. Yes, Lord, You are worthy of all blessing and honor, glory and power, riches and wisdom and strength. We come before You, Lord, and we declare that You are the El Elyon, the Most High God. You are El Shaddai, God Almighty. You are Jehovah Jireh, our provider. You are Jehovah Nisi, our banner of love and victory. For You said in Your word, the Song of Songs, chapter 2, that He took me into His banquet hall, the marriage supper of the Lamb, and His banner over me was love. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. And Lord, we just receive, Lord, hallelujah, Your loving kindness, Lord. And we remember You, Lord, at a love feast, every love feast that we have. Love feast is another name for the communion, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. We come to the table of the Lord. You know, brothers and sisters, I just made a video the other day, and the Lord was, you know, wanting me to tell you guys, you know, that He just wants to walk with us in the cool of the day. And the Lord said at the Last Supper, He said, how often have I wanted, have I desired to have this meal with You, to break bread with You, to commune with us. And so when you see all these high theologians, you know, I studied all that stuff in school, and you see these high theologians, when you have the false doctrine of cannibalism, of transubstantiation, they call it, from the Catholic Church, that you literally eat the flesh and blood of Jesus. And even the Lutherans also believe that. Then you've got the reformers who said, no, you know, it's not the literal blood of Jesus and the literal physical body of Jesus. We're not cannibals, but we do it in remembrance of Him. And all those things, they're missing the point, brothers and sisters. That's the problem with high theologians and all that kind of stuff, see? You know, the only reason why we have to bring theology is to keep out wacky doctrines. You know, and that's part of what I do in my ministry, but that's the part I don't like, because it's not about that. It's not about that. Jesus said, you know, that at that same Last Supper, Jesus said that I give you a new commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you, that the world may know that you're My disciples because you have loved one for another. Hallelujah. And Jesus said that we're supposed to love God with everything, with our heart, mind, soul, body, everything, and love our neighbor as ourselves. And Jesus said we would be His friends if we do the things He said, those things I just mentioned, that we would be His friends, not even more disciples, but friends. Hallelujah. And that's what the Lord desires. As Jesus said to the woman at the well, God is not, you know, and you know, that's a great message. I just used that same text last time too. Thank You, Lord. The woman at the well in John chapter 4, she found out that, you know, Jesus was supposed to be the Messiah. The first thing she did when she found out, you know, Jesus only revealed himself to two people besides some of his disciples. Two people, the man that was blind, who was kicked out of the synagogue because he didn't deny the Lord. So the Lord, you know, rewarded him by revealing himself as the Messiah. Who is the Messiah that I may worship him? And he revealed himself. And then the blind man who was blind got his sight, worshiped the Lord. And then the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman, when she found out he's the Messiah, what was the first question you asked the Messiah? You know, and that's a lot of people on YouTube. That's the whole thing. That's what I'm trying to get at. Praise you, Lord. It's a message from the Lord. That when they meet the Lord, the first thing you want to ask them is some old, you know, off the wall, kind of sideline, you know, majored in the minor, some minor little issue. You know, well, when you got pierced, was the nail through your wrist or through your hands? I've been debating that all for 25 years with somebody, that when the nails were pierced, it was through the center of your hand. And my friend said he believed it would be through the wrist because you'd fall off the cross if it was through your hand and not through your wrist. Things like that. Is that the first thing you're going to ask Jesus? What the woman at the well said? She said, well, you know, our ancestors said we're supposed to worship God here on this mountain here. And then, the Jews say it's supposed to be in Jerusalem. Which is it? And, the Lord gave the priority. He said, you know, the time is coming and now is that God doesn't want you to worship him on a mountain here in Samaria or in Jerusalem. But the God is a spirit, and he wants those who worship him to worship him in spirit and in truth, brothers and sisters. That's what I'm talking about. That's a message from the Lord. This is a continuation of the message, praise God, that I just gave you the other day from the Lord. He wants to walk with us in the cool of the day. He wants to break bed with us. He wants to sit down with us. Hallelujah. That's what the Last Supper's about. And people talking about all this stuff and going on and on, you know, trivial stuff. We're talking about sitting down with the Creator of the universe, with the Word of God, with the Lord Jesus Christ, who loved us and gave himself for us. We're talking about the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. We're talking about, you know, God so loved the world that he gave us what? He gave us the Mashiach. He gave us Christ. He gave us the Messiah. Hallelujah. He gave us Jesus Christ. Who has given Jesus Christ his Son? And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks. You know, so that's from the Bible too. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. You know, to break bread with the Lord. What does it say what Jesus did at the Last Supper? I should tell this video, you know, what Jesus did at the Last Supper. I don't know. That's what the Lord has given me. He took the bread and he gave thanks to the Father and he broke it. Hallelujah. And gave unto them. Said, here, take this, my body. So it's about the thankfulness and the love and the joy of communing with the Creator of the universe. Can you get it through your head? He wants. You know, I had a dream last night. And, you know, I had to stop because the dream the Lord gave me. The Lord had been giving me, you know, the dreams about going to Germany. Those who watch my videos and doing ministry there. And then last night, the Lord gave me a dream about to minister to Wesleyan people in the United States and the UK. Now, you know, that's the dream that the Lord gave me. That he showed me being used by God to pray for spiritual healing. Not just physical healing, but people being spiritually delivered from false doctrine and all this kind of stuff. In the Wesleyan church. That's what the Lord had in my dream. And I forgot these other parts of the dream. And just as I was speaking, the Lord brought it back to me. That's what's so awesome about God. You know? And so the part that snapped when I did like that, snapped in my memory from the Lord, was in my dream. I was ministering to those Wesleyans, because I was focused on that. You know, my mind was focused on, well, I guess the Lord's going to send me to the UK. I like to call it Great Britain, you know, the UK, and to Wesleyan churches in the United States. That's my focus. Well, like, you know, because I'm trying to, you know, go where the Lord wants me to go and do ministry. Okay. See what I'm saying? We can't take it. It's all about Jesus. We can't even put it about ministry. It's got to be about Jesus. And so above where the Lord would send me, you know, God's everywhere. And he wants to worship us, to worship him in spirit and truth and commune with him wherever we're at. Whether we go to Germany, Philippines, or you yourself, wherever you are, UK, some sisters that watch, there's a sister that watches in Scotland, at least one that I know of, and lots of places, Australia, etc. But anyway, so what I was ministering to them and what I was saying to them, each one of those Wesleyans, I was praying for them to be healed. But then the Lord showed me that it was a spiritual healing, not a physical healing.
Okay? They had all like this damage in their heart, and I could like see into their bodies and see all these scars inside their heart and all that. Of course, it makes common sense that it's talking about spiritual stuff and false doctrine, etc. But what I was telling them was is that the Lord wants you to have a personal relationship with Him. And then those Wesleyan people, each one of them that I talked to one-on-one, there was like 10 of them, or how many of there was, and it was a small number. One of them, you know, says to me, yeah, that's what I want. He said, that's what you spirit-filled, born-again Christians have. You have that personal relationship with the Lord, and that's what I want. That's what I want so bad. That's what he was saying to me. And every one of them, it was kind of like the same thing over and over again. But I talked to them one-on-one, and then there was a group that I dealt with. It was in the UK. The first group was American, the second group was UK. So that's the part I was focusing on. Hallelujah. But the part that the Lord wants to convey to me and you guys, or you all, or y'all, as we say, is it's about that personal relationship with Jesus. That's why it's so funny when, I mean, the Lord is just, I mean, it's just so simple, brothers and sisters. I mean, Jesus said you had to become like a little child to enter the kingdom of heaven. So people make it so complicated, you know? And what the Lord wants you to know is that if you are a Christian, you have a person. To be a Christian is to have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. To be a follower of Jesus, that's His lordship over us. To follow Jesus and obey Jesus, but that we have a personal relationship with Him. And you know, I've heard, that's why it always trips me out with denominational churches. Now here in the Philippines, as an example, I've done all these, for several years I went to the remote areas, to, you know, communist rebel areas, before my son was born, and then the Muslim areas and all these places, very dangerous. But, you know, I just said, hey, God's going to make a way. The Lord's going to make a way. If something's going to happen to me, you know, get martyred for Christ, hey, it's up to the Lord. It's up to you, Lord. And I went to these places, and some of the places nobody would go, but there was a group called the Bible Baptists. They have Bible Baptists in the States. They're like the most hard-shell Baptists. Everybody's going to hell but us Baptists there are. You know, it's like speaking in tongues is from the devil and all that. And King James only, or you're going to hell. All these kind of things. So, of course, I love the King James, but I don't say you're going to hell if you don't read it. But if you want the most accurate translation in English that you can get, it's King James. But, of course, nothing matches being able to, you know, speak ancient Hebrew and Greek. But, you know, you got, very few people have a doctorate in ancient, you know, Hebrew, you know, to be able to read it and understand it the way it was meant to be written. Because words change meaning all the time. You know, so you have to know the meaning of when it was, the time it was written. Anyway, so that's why we need some experts to give us a translation that God would assign. I like the King James Version. And so, well, when the only people that would go to these remote areas in these dangerous areas was the Bible Baptist pastors. And so I went with them because these people had never heard the gospel, and that's what it's all about. I don't care about doctrine other than, of course, number one, it's salvation by grace through faith. And, you know, the gifts of the Spirit and all this stuff is awesome, but people got to be born again. I mean, that's what you need to go to heaven, and that's what it's all about. So I went with them because it's all about evangelizing people, not getting into doctrine. But when I went there, I was listening to them, and of course I preached, and then the Bible Baptist preachers were preaching too, and they were telling people, oh, it's about a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. They told everybody that, and that's true, but I was thinking at the time, which is true, because they were vehemently anti-Holy Spirit people. And I would just laugh and, you know, to myself, and I finally talked to them later on after several months. I was just like, how is it that you say you have a personal relationship with Jesus, but you don't know the Holy Spirit? You know, that's the part I can't figure out. Because, how, you know, they're all one, but yet there's, you know, it's one what and three who's. You know, there's one God, and it's in, like they say, it's a candle with three wicks on it. One candle with three different flames on it, as an example. There's all these different things. I've done lots of teachings about the Trinity. And I don't want to get into that doctrine. That's not what I'm talking. That's exactly the opposite of what we're talking about. But, brothers and sisters, if you know Jesus, the only way you can come to become a born-again Christian is with an encounter with the Holy Spirit. Because Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father, ever making intercession for His people, for His church. The Lord's overseeing His church, like in Revelation chapter 2 and chapter 1, 2, and 3. The Lord in that church age, which is represented right there, Jesus is overseeing His church. Overseeing His church. Oh, that reminds me. There's some new stuff the Lord showed me from Revelation chapter 4 that also ties into the fact that, well, of course, Revelation 4, chapter 4, verse 1 is a type of the rapture. It's pointing to the rapture. After that, the church is not mentioned anymore to the end of the book. But anyway, there's some other things the Lord had showed me in there that shows it's the post-rapture at that point. Anyway, brothers and sisters, hallelujah. We've got to have a personal relationship with Jesus. We've got to spend time with the Lord. As an example, and I've talked about this before, I could write a book. I could go research right now, President Trump. I can go research President Trump and study all about him. As a matter of fact, I've never been active in politics, but I've watched a lot of President Trump's speeches because the Lord was leading me to last year. It was from the Lord because I already knew in my spirit he was going to win. Like I said, I don't talk about politics in my videos. I've already been following Trump since 2008. And I knew if he ever ran, he'd be president. And I was saying it for 2 or 3 years to relatives who are all non-Christians. And then, of course, they laughed. But, you know, the Lord used it as a witness against them because I already told them in my spirit, Trump's going to be president. And, of course, it happened. So it was a witness from the Lord. But anyhow, I know President Trump. I've watched a bunch of his speeches. And, you know, I could write a book about President Trump. I could research online. I could write a book without having never met him. But if President Trump showed up here today and came to this house and walked in, I'd be like, hey, what's up, President Trump? And he's going to be like, well, what's your name? I don't know you. See? So you can know about Jesus without knowing Jesus. So a lot of times when you're talking about high theologians, because like I say, I'll just say this. It all ties in. Because the Lord always gives me stuff and it turns out, you know, I think I mentioned it in the video, the Lord had me looking at theology stuff to review, because I haven't reviewed it since I went to school, about the Trinity and all that, just a few weeks ago, out of the blue. About Christmas time, the Lord had me reviewing all about theology, systematic theology it's called, and about the Trinity and all this kind of stuff, you know. And anyway, I was looking at that, and the smartest man, I love to hear smart people talk, like Robbie Zacharias. Of course, he's not a theologian. He's an apologist. But R.C. Sproul, even though he's a Reformed theologian, and so, of course, in Reformed theology, they don't believe in the, you know, in the literal millennial reign of Christ. They don't believe in the rapture. They believe it's all happened in history and all that. But as far as the Trinity and all that, it's all the same. Anyway, so R.C. Sproul is a man I highly respect. And, you know, the Lord led me to start watching a bunch of his videos for about a week. And then he died. I didn't even know he was sick. You know, I mean, I didn't even know how old he was. You know, I knew he was old, pretty old. But anyway, he died, you know. So it's like the Lord was leading me to look at his stuff at the time he died. So he was in my spirit, you know. But I thought about it, you know, in my spirit. You know, R.C. Sproul was a very, one of the smartest people ever. As a matter of fact, I saw he did an interview I want to recommend something to you. If you like apologetics, you don't know what it is, Google it. Ben Stein, who's not a Christian, he's Jewish. But Ben Stein went around and he talked about how that in universities, they're kicking out people, they kick out professors that don't agree with evolution. Any Christian or Jewish, you know, believing God, it doesn't necessarily be Christian, but believing God, Jews or Christians are being kicked out of academia if they say anything against evolution. And so he did a documentary called Expelled. And so, which is great, but if you're dealing with that issue of how, you know, the universities are anti-Christian, we already know that, but this is that one area about evolution is a farce, and then they defend it, and they'll fire you and get rid of you if you don't agree with their false lie of evolution. And so anyway, Dr. R.C. Sproul was interviewing Ben Stein about it. So two very smart people. I always like and admire very smart men, and both of the smart people. And Ben Stein is a genius, and so was R.C. Sproul. And they were talking. They never met. And Ben Stein, of all people, is one of the smartest people in the world, told R.C. Sproul, you know, I've never met you before, but you are one of the smartest people I've ever met. So, I mean, you know, people, you know, they had admired each other for that. But my point is that when I'm watching that stuff, and then after he died, it was like in my spirit that, you know, R.C. Sproul had studied all of this. Somebody's got to do it, okay? And I think it's great. I mean, somebody's got to be a high theologian. Someone has to be an expert in ancient Hebrew and then try to figure out what the word meant when it was written. So in other words, if you look at the Genesis, excuse me, or Exodus and all that that Moses wrote in 1500 BC, and the wording used there, the meaning of a word could have been different by the time you get to Malachi. It's like 1,000 years later, when Malachi was written, you could have the exact same word with a meaning that has evolved. As an example, I've used this all the time in videos. If I mention it, the word gay. If you used the word gay 100 years ago, it meant happy, whereas today gay means a homosexual man. The word fag. You know, in England, they call a cigarette a fag, and actually a fag is a stick. And like my grandfather was in World War II, and I went to the Greatest Generation stuff. I was doing family history, and I went to the reunion of the World War II veterans. I think they're all dead now, but I went in 1999 before I started the ministry. And so they were using the word fag to talk about cigarettes. They said, yeah, I used to smoke fags, but everybody smoked fags back then, but we stopped. And, of course, I'd already heard that word. I knew that British use it, so I knew what he meant, cigarettes. But today it means, a gay man, a slur for a gay man. So words evolve and change. And so anyway, I thought in my spirit about R.C. Sproul, that he had all of this head knowledge and wisdom. But yet, brothers, I had to pause at something that's going on with my computer. He had all this head knowledge, brothers and sisters, but, I believe he was a Christian, but it's robotic. And of course, like I say, I loved him as a brother in Christ, very smart man. I know he loved the Lord. But, I'm thinking that when he got there, he found out, because he was part of that Strange Fire conference. But there's a mean-spirited dude that ran that anti-Pentecostal stuff called the Strange Fire Conference. That's John MacArthur, very mean-spirited man. Now, R.C. Sproul's not a mean-spirited person, but he's in that group, anti-Pentecostalism, that's not for today. God doesn't do that anymore. As a matter of fact, they're anti-rapture, they're anti-literal interpretation of the thousand-year reign of Christ and all that. And like I said, he still said it in love. R.C. Sproul was a man with love in his heart, unlike in John MacArthur, as just an example. But anyway, I wonder when he got there that he found out that all that knowledge ends up being you have to be like a little child in the kingdom of heaven. You know what I'm saying? But praise God. The thing about, as I mentioned about R.C. Sproul, a man like him, and I always say that about R.C. Sproul. He was pastoring a church before, but a guy like that doesn't need to be pastoring a church. He needs to be teaching pastors. He needs to be a professor in a seminary teaching pastors. But it always has to go back to about love. We need to know those things so we can talk to atheists. And, it's not information that the church needs to know that way, other than people who are dealing with atheists and agnostics and trying to talk to Muslims about the difference of, explaining the Trinity to Muslims, and things like that. But actually, brothers and sisters, that's just the intellectual stuff. Let me say this, because the Lord is leading me. I have a brother that was atheist, and now he's agnostic, and now he's kind of moving even a little bit closer to, to belief in the God of the Bible. But it all started, he was a hardcore atheist and believed in evolution and all that, because he had never heard anything different. And then while I was going to school, I was, using the information that I learned about evolution versus creation and all that stuff to talk to him, kind of practicing on him and people that my friends and relatives that I knew that were not Christians. And the thing is that intellectual stuff like that casts a shadow of a doubt on their ironclad faith in evolution. So that's the purpose of that stuff. You cast doubt on the ironclad evolution in their mind, the ironclad belief in evolution. You give them a shadow of a doubt where they say, their faith in evolution is broken. And then they, their eyes are open that, to other possibilities. That, the evidence is not rock solid like I just supposed that the evidence for evolution was rock solid. But I found out that it's not rock solid. As a matter of fact, it's nothing. It's almost nothing. But it opens up their mind to the possibilities that they could be wrong. And that's all the intellectual part. That's just to open the door, brothers and sisters, with intellectual thinking. But when it comes to the heart, to becoming a born-again Christian, it's a matter of becoming as a little child. It's a matter of a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And I've sang that song many times, in the garden. I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ears. the sound of God discloses, you know, that he walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. Hallelujah. I come to the garden, you know. And so, and I mentioned that the other day and sang that song. I come to the garden alone. You know, God has no grandchildren. I go there alone to meet with Jesus. You go there, if you're a born-again Christian, to meet with Jesus. I go there to meet with Jesus. God is everywhere. The Lord can meet with me at the same time he's meeting with 10,000 other people. Hallelujah. And the joy we share, no one else has ever known. Yeah, because my personal relationship with Jesus is a personal relationship. So, you know, it's just like, well, thank you, Lord. The Lord's just reminding me of this today. I was saying, you know, when I was a kid, I mean, see, the Lord, it was in my mind today is connected to this. I didn't even know it. I didn't even realize that was connected from the Lord. I was thinking about how when we went to the States, you know, my son, I don't know why kids are like that. They love their grandparents, grandpas, you know. My son loved my dad, even though, you know, my dad could be a jerk to me, you know, because he's my dad. But my son does things like he's the greatest thing since peanut butter. And then I was thinking about that. And then I was thinking about that when I was a kid. You know, I thought my grandpa was awesome. And then my dad, I heard my dad saying, I was a little kid, and my dad was saying, you know, I can't believe that, you know, his dad is being so nice to us and that he was like shocked. And then my mom was telling him, well, you know, that's grandparents are different than parents. And it's true. My grandpa was very strict. And when he was younger, he used to really spank, you know, use the word beat them a lot. My dad and his other brother and younger kids, my grandpa lightened up. But back, my dad was the second oldest. My grandpa was young. He was something else. I mean, he was really violent person. And anyhow, but with us, it was just like he was never spanked us, never raised his voice at us, never got mad. Totally different person. And that's what I'm saying. The relationship that we have with God, each of us have our own relationship with God. You know, so there are people who have a lot of sin in their life and the Lord reveals himself to them about the fear of judgment because that's what they need. So when people tell you, oh, you know, the Lord is reminding me, he's giving me more. That same grandfather's wife, my grandmother, she was a Christian since she was a little kid. And her sister, she had a sister the next in line after her. And my grandma was always talking about fire and brimstone. But her sister, who was like 2 years younger than her, she just died last year. She was always talking about the love of Jesus. You know, everybody needs to know just about the love of Jesus. Not about a relationship like what I'm talking about, but the love of Jesus. And my grandma was like, everybody needs to know about the judgment of God if you don't repent and get saved. But it's like, that's how they knew God, because of their situation. Obviously, maybe my grandma was, you know, she needed it, you know. But you know what I'm saying? So the Lord, Paul said, I become all things to all people that I might win some to Christ. And so the Lord presents himself. The Lord is giving me more examples. I've just got to go with it. And I've talked about this before. In the Old Testament, it's so funny with all these Judaizers and wacky people on YouTube saying that, oh, you've got to call, you know, the Lord El Shaddai, or I mentioned that earlier, El Elyon, Jehovah Nisi, which I started with that in this video. See how the Lord orchestrates everything? All those names of God are not the names of God, but attributes of God. So when God revealed himself that time at the battle there, every time Moses lifted up his arms, the children of Israel would win under the general Joshua, who later became the leader. And every time his arms would go down, they would lose. And then at the end of the thing, you know, Noah proclaimed, you know, put up a monument of rocks there and said, you know, Jehovah Nisi, God is my banner, you know, like our victory banner. But that's not his name, Jehovah Nisi. It's an attribute of God, a revelation of God, a glimpse of who God is and the character of God. All those names, like even Yahweh. And he said, who do I say people are? Tell them that I am that I am. God revealed himself to Moses and to the children of Israel with that name. That's not his name. That's an attribute of who God is. He always is. You know, and then Jesus used that again. I am the way, the truth, and life. I am the bread of life. His name is not, I am the bread of life. It's a revelation or a way that God would, the Lord would present himself to somebody. So you're like yourself. You know, he said, give us this day our daily bread. You are hungry for a word and you need to hear something for God. And then a word drops into your spirit. And then you say, well, you know, the Lord's given me my daily bread. Jesus is, you know, I am the bread of life. Jesus is the bread of life. He gave me this bread, this word that I needed to hear. So in that moment, he presented himself to you as the bread of life, as the living bread. Such a kind, not like the manna, all you Judaizers. John chapter 6, Jesus said, your ancestors ate manna in the wilderness, and now they're dead. That bread didn't do them any good. Moses didn't give them that bread, as Jesus said, but God gave them that bread. They kept trying to say, Moses gave us this bread, which is blasphemous. And Jesus corrected them and said, no, Moses didn't give you any bread, but it came down from my Father who's in heaven. But I am the bread of life. If you eat this bread, this is such a kind that if you eat, you'll never die. Not like they ate in the wilderness and then later on they died. But this bread, if you eat this bread, hallelujah, receive the Lord Jesus Christ in yourself. Going back to the communion, you receive the bread, the living God in your spirit, then you'll live eternally. Just like Jesus told the woman at the well. He said that I have water that I would give you. And if you would drink, you would never die. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And you would never thirst again. You would never die. Hallelujah. Jesus is all those things. He revealed himself to the woman at the well as the living water. He revealed himself as I am the bread of life to those people. When he went there on the Feast of Dedication, also known as Hanukkah, he said, I am the light of the world. That's not his name. That's an attribute of who he is. He revealed himself in that moment to those people. I am the light of the world. So the Lord wants to reveal himself to people in the way they need this, what they need to connect with God and have that personal relationship. You know, so today the Lord could reveal himself to you as the bread of life. Tomorrow, you know, he's going to reveal, you know, you. It's Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. So then when you get hungry and thirsty to be sanctified, to stop living in sin and being involved in those dead denominations, and you decide, hey, I want to be a spirit-filled, on-fire servant of God, and I want to, you know, be all I can be in Christ and stop trying to do the minimum, but try to walk in the fullness, as Paul said, that you might know the fullness of Christ. What is the depth and the width and the length? You know, in the height of the love of Christ, to be filled with the fullness of Christ, to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, blessed in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. So you want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. You want to be filled with the fullness of the wisdom of God that we can, as much as we can stand in our spirit, that our cup might runneth over. Psalm 23. The Psalm of the Messiah, the Good Shepherd Psalm that King David wrote. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, brothers and sisters. So let the Lord be what you need today. Think of all the names of Christ. What is it that, you know, what is it that you need today? You know, you're hungry and thirsting for righteousness. Jesus said, you know, the water I'll give you, you'll never thirst again. Hallelujah. Praise God. We see in John chapter 7, he said that he who believes on me, out of his belly will flow rivers of living water. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Get a hold of Jesus. Have that personal relationship with him. I mean, how did you ask yourself? You know, that's why we have so many false converts in the church. Ask yourself. The Bible says, judge yourself so that God doesn't have to. The Bible says in James that the Bible is a mirror. James chapter 2. When a man reads it, he's beholding his own self. It's about you looking at yourself in that mirror. Ask yourself, how did you get born again? What happened when you became a Christian? How did the Lord present himself to you? A lot of people got saved as little kids, you know, as a little child. And so the Lord came as the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. You know, Jesus loves me, this I know. Suffer little children to come unto me and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven. That's what, when I got saved, I was 8 years old. And that's what the Lord drew me to give my life to Jesus in Vacation Bible School. They had an altar call, and the Lord drew me there. Because he loved, you know, what got me was, that you know, his love. Hallelujah, because I was a little kid. Suffer little children to come unto me and forbid them not. So what was it that drew you to Jesus? How did the Lord present himself to you? That's an attribute of him. The Lord has millions and millions of attributes that we don't even know.
Hallelujah, praise God. We are four-dimensional beings living in a three-dimensional world. You're talking about hyperdimensions. You're talking about stuff well beyond. You know, it's like a little stick man trying to see what's going on in a three-dimensional world. You can't do it. You can only just get a little glimpse and a little hint of what's going on in the hyperdimensions. You know, way up far above all gods. Hallelujah is our Lord. He is El Elyon, the Most High God. Yes. Yes, Lord God, we worship you. Let's worship him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. We bless you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, Lord God. We exalt you, Lord. We exalt thee. We exalt thee. Oh, Lord. Hallelujah. We exalt thee. We exalt thee. Oh, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Yes, Lord. Thou art far above all of the earth. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. We bless you, Lord God. Hallelujah. 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 Lord, we praise you. Lord, we praise you. Yes, Lord God. To him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb. Yes, Lord. To him who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb. Be blessing and honor and glory and power forever. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord God. Yes. And unto you be all the glory. Yes, Lord. And unto you be all the glory. Yes, Lord. We bless you, Lord. Yes, Lord. The angels dance around you. Yes. Hallelujah, Lord God. Hallelujah. Open up the heavens, Lord. Let your kingdom come to earth. Yes, Lord. My praises all surround you. My soul can't dance without you. Yes, Lord. Open up the heavens, Lord. Let your kingdom come to earth. Yes, Lord. And unto you be all the glory. And unto you be all the glory. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord God. We receive the fire of your Spirit, Lord God. Lord, touch your people with your fire, Lord God, of holiness, of righteousness, of peace in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We proclaim you our King. Standing here in the midst of us, we lift you up with our praise. And as we worship, build your throne. And as we worship, build your throne. Come, Lord Jesus, and take your place. And as we worship, build your throne. And as we worship, build your throne. Come, Lord Jesus, and take your place. Hallelujah. Father, we worship you, Lord God. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. Lord, I know, Lord God, even as I just shared a video on Facebook of a word you gave me in 2011, you would send forth revival to gather in those last sheep to come into thy kingdom, Lord God. Hallelujah. Let the word go forth to many nations. Hallelujah. That Christ is King. Hallelujah. We speak to nations. Hallelujah.
be open. Powers of darkness, you have to flee. We speak to nations. The kingdom is coming near to you. Hallelujah. We speak to strongholds. Be broken. Yes, Lord. Powers of darkness, you have to flee. We speak to nations. The kingdom is coming near to you. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord God. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 If you want to enter into the worship and receive revival, receive the fire of God, the power of the Holy Spirit upon you. Dozens of people that have contacted me. I don't know how many, more than that, but dozens of people have contacted me and received the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the experienced the blessing of the manifested outpouring of God's Spirit. A touch of revival. Hallelujah. You can receive it through anywhere in the world. Hallelujah. The Lord is above and beyond space and time. Hallelujah. He's outside, as I said, he's hyper dimension, way beyond, far above all gods. Hallelujah. We exalt the Lord our God. We exalt the Lord our God. Hallelujah. And worship him. Hallelujah. He's worthy. He is worthy. You know, a lot of people, you know, they don't care about praise and worship and all that. You know, there's the people that are intellectual people, the denominational Protestant people, very intellectual. They want to stay right here in the mind, in that mental ascent, as John Wesley said. You know, they don't want to be a holy roller. That holy rollers came from people back in the 1700s, long before the modern day Pentecostal movement. John Wesley started the Methodist Church and the Wesleyan Church. They broke off from them. Was part of the Great Awakening in the United States back at the time of the Revolutionary War. He went to New York City. They thought the people were drunk. The police tried to arrest people. There was over 600. In the morning, I think it's 6,000 or 600. I used to know. People rolling around on the ground all night, wrestling with the angel of the Lord to get born again. Wasn't some going down, you know, and say the sinner's prayer in 30 seconds and out back the same way they were? False converts? No, they got convicted under the power of God, of the holiness of God, of their sin. And they rolled around. That's where the term holy roller comes from. They were rolling around on the ground under the manifested presence, the weighty presence of the glory of God. And when they got the vision and they looked in that mirror and they saw they were sinners, unrighteous, unholy, undeserved. So the word grace means unearned, undeserved forgiveness, undeserved favor. The word grace, people, that's the problem. People forgot, you know, don't know the meaning of word because we just say it, grace. What does that mean? It means you don't deserve squat. You can keep the law all day long. You don't earn God's love. As Paul said in Romans chapter 4, if you can earn it, then God owes you a wage. For what you've done, God owes you $100 because you worked all day for him. No. Grace means something you can never earn. It's by faith. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. That's the problem with people. So prideful in their intellect and all this other wacky stuff. Instead of becoming like a little child and childlike faith and trust in God and confessing that they're a sinner. All this nonsense and as I call it, greasy grace, hyper grace, whatever you want to call it. People who thinking that, and that's the thing, people don't have an ear to hear. God's grace is not greasy, but the devil's false gospel is greasy. You just say, oh, I heard the gospel and I just agreed in my mind it must be true. And hey, that's all I got to do. I go live like the devil just like I did the day before. And I'm a new creature. Behold, all things are new. The old things have passed away, but behold, all things come new. Become new, you become a new man, a new creature in Christ. That means you've changed. There's been a change. Hallelujah, you've been delivered. I once was lost in sin until Jesus took me in. Just a little light from heaven filled my soul. Hallelujah. Praise God. just a little talk with Jesus is the name of that song. Hallelujah, that we have a little talk with Jesus, that we get set free. Those whom the Son sets free are free indeed. He who lives in sin is a slave to sin, Jesus said. But those whom the Son sets free are free indeed. Hallelujah, get free in Jesus Christ. You say you're a Christian, but you're not free? Well, then did Jesus lie? Or is something wrong on your end of this thing, you know? There's a problem with you, not a problem with Jesus. There's not a problem with the Bible. There's not a problem with the Word. You know, as I was talking to a brother last night, there's no errors in the Bible. There's apparent errors. You can have an apparent error. You have not understood something. The Bible's not wrong. You're wrong. You know, so Jesus said, those whom the Son sets free are free indeed. They're not anymore captive. So if you still have addictions and bondages in your life, you haven't been set free by Jesus. You need to go to the one who can save you, to the one who can set you free. That's what we're talking about. Personal relationship with Jesus, not a mental agreement. This is in the spirit. Deep calls unto deep. This is not in the flesh. I don't literally go down here and plant a garden and walk to a garden and meet the Lord there. As I already gave you the words from the Lord from John chapter 4. He's a spirit. He wants us to worship Him in spirit and truth right where we are. Not go to this place and go to that place, not only in Jerusalem or there. You know, and I've done, you know, one of the first messages I ever preached about revival. That's one of my revival. The Lord's let me give one of my revival messages. I go into church all the time and I say, why do you keep calling this place a sanctuary? This is a building. When Christians are here gathered in His name, then it's a sanctuary. We are the sanctuary of God. We are the body of Christ. Individually, if you're a born-again Christian, your heart is a sanctuary of the Spirit of God. And then when we gather, it says, Jesus said, where two or more gather in my name, there I'm in the midst of you. So if you have 10 people and we meet in a house, that's the church. Don't let any religion, there's a religious sister, you know. And when, you know, when I said that, she was like making a joke out of it. No, that's what Jesus said. Don't bring your, you know, your organized religion up on what the Lord said. All this old pomp, that's the same thing the Jews did. They turned it into pomp and circumstance and ceremony. That's what the Catholic Church has done. It's not about that. It's about a personal relationship with Jesus, one-on-one. And then when we gather in His name, as we gather, may your Spirit move within us. As we gather, may we glorify your name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Brothers and sisters, so if you have a group of people get together in the church, that's the sanctuary, is the people. Not that building. People keep, you know, they start reading those Bible verses about the temple and all that. They start applying it like this is a temple. That's all a shadow. What made the temple? And Jesus even talked about that. What made the temple holy? The offering or, you know, God. The presence of God in the Holy of Holies and around that ark is what made it holy. God made it holy. Not their ceremonies and all that nonsense. Same thing's true in the New Testament. A church building is just a place where Christians gather. But the Christians are the one who bring God there. The Spirit of God is there in the hearts of those believers who go there. Where the church is assembled anywhere. On the street, at the beach, in the house. You know, with green eggs and ham, with a cat. Whatever. That's where the Lord is, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. Praise God. I keep going because the Lord is leading me. You know the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me and other people to preach good news to the poor. Hallelujah. Those who are poor in spirit. Hallelujah. To set the captives free. To preach liberty to those who are bound. To open the eyes of the blind. Hallelujah. And preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And the year of the vengeance of our God. Hallelujah. That's what's coming, brothers and sisters. We are in the acceptable year of the Lord. You know, I made a video a while back, and some of those people run to and fro looking for the rapture. I said, we are living in the year of Jubilee. And I think I titled the video that we're in the year of Jubilee. Oh, so that means the rapture is going to be this year? No, brothers and sisters. From that text, the year of Jubilee is the church age. Those years of Jubilee are a shadow and a type to point to the acceptable year of the Lord. It's not the one year for them, for Jews, every 50th year, but for us, it's the church age, brothers and sisters. This is the year of Jubilee where all debts are forgiven. All sin is forgiven. Everything's restored in Christ. That's the church age that we're living in. But what's coming is the year of the vengeance of our God. That's the tribulation, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. That's for Israel and those who are left behind. the year of the vengeance of our God. Right now we are living in the acceptable year of the Lord, the year of Jubilee, a.k.a. the age of grace, the church age. Hallelujah. Call upon the Lord while he may be found. He has an ear to hear you. Hallelujah. His arm is not too short that he can't reach down. Or his ear, you know, that he's deaf that he can't hear you. I believe that's Isaiah 58. I think. It's been a long time since I read that text. Praise God, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to cut it off. And I praise God for anybody that's watching this video to the end. Hallelujah. You know, praise God. God bless you. The people that watch my videos and watch the whole thing, you know, I do it for you guys because the Lord loves you guys and uses me to minister to you. That's why I do it. I'm doing it for the Lord. But the Lord's, let me say it that way. I'm doing it for the Lord. I'm preaching to a one man audience. I use the word man, the Son of Man, Jesus Christ. But for you guys who watch it, the Lord's doing it for you. Hallelujah. I praise God for it. Of course, I also learn too. You know, it's for me too. Of course, I'm only a human. Just like anybody else other than the Lord, right? Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you all. I love you all very much. I'll be back in the States in a few weeks. I'm praying about where I'm going to go. You know, every year that I've gone back to the States now for the last, this will be the fourth year, I think, that I've been going to the States. And, you know, no, you know, it hasn't worked out where someone's like, hey, you know, the Lord is leading me. You need to come here and start a church, and I'm going to, you know, help you in all this. I had one brother that wants to do that, but he's been going through a lot right now and what the Lord's doing with him and his personal life. And, you know, I think he's in the middle of the different phases in order to do it right now. And, but anyway, ask for your prayers. You know, I've been, since I started going to the States, I've been asking the Lord, you know, I've done a few churches. I used to do a lot in the States before I moved to the Philippines. I believe and I know the Lord's going to open those doors so I can get in there and preach that revivals. That's what God wants. The Lord wants. It's just I don't know when that's going to happen. And that's been my prayer that the Lord would send me in there for that last harvest to get the Church of the Firstborn. And the Church of the Firstborn is just the name the Lord gave me for our group. But it's not this group. The Church of the Firstborn is in the Bible there in Hebrews chapter 12. And it's talking about those who are going to be raptured, okay? So I want to gather those last people in that are part of the wise virgins. That's part of the Church of the Firstborn that will be raptured. That's what the Lord called me to do. My whole ministry. And I'm waiting for those final doors to be opened to bring in that last harvest. I know it's going to happen. I just don't know when. Ask for your prayers and guidance of where I need to move, what I need to do. I'm just waiting on the Lord. And it's totally up to the Lord. I know the Lord's going to open the right doors and close the wrong ones. Anyway, brothers and sisters, love you all very much. And I'm hoping to get to see a bunch of you guys in the States. I want to get back to Dallas, to Minneapolis, and all those points in between, of course, as the Lord leads. And if you're still watching this video, okay. You know, I haven't been up there in the Northeast, you know, because the Lord had to lead me to go up there. Because I don't necessarily care to go to some big, you know, cities like, of course, I went to Chicago, to New York and places like that. You know, it's stressful to travel in places like that. Unless the Lord, you know, sends me there. But anyway, it looks like I'll be going to Rochester, New York. And I'll wait till it warms up, unless the Lord tells me different, you know, maybe in May. Washington, D.C., and Maryland. I'll be in Eastern Shore of Maryland when it starts getting warm. Let's say April or May. It's up to the Lord. And Rochester, New York. So by the grace of God, people in between there, let me know. Let's make a plan as the Lord leads. God bless you all. And I'll be in Vancouver again. I think it's going to be in September. And then next February, a year from this month, it's supposed to be in New Zealand. So praise God. Praise God. And then after that, sometime in there, I'm going to Germany. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you all. God bless you all.